want to thank RSPE for having us here tonight and thank everyone for coming. This is really, really amazing and beyond anything I could have imagined, you know, 10 years ago when we were getting this off the ground. And when I was asked to speak tonight, I thought I'd spend some of my time talking about the history of Universal Audio, my dad, and maybe some personal insights on that, and then what this last 10 years have been like. And a question I always get asked is, you know, how do we approach emulating the analog recreation? So I was going to talk about that a little bit. So I wanted to start with the early history, and Universal Audio started. My dad started recording in Chicago after World War II, but it really, I think, the seeds of what he did goes back before that. When I think about stories he told me and things I know about him, his personality, you know, first of all, he was into technology, you know, at the time. He was into radio, and something I shared with him, I'll talk a little bit about that later. But if he's anything like when I first experienced, you know, radio, made my first crystal set, and then a shortwave receiver, and tuned in the BBC, it was magic. You know, it's like that was the moment that struck me. And that's something my dad introduced me to. And I can only imagine that that really did the same thing for him. I mean, radio has been around a lot longer than my dad is, but still holds that magic to me. And I can't imagine what it was like in the, you know, early 30s when he was making crystal sets and then went on to work on car radio sets. So I think, you know, that's something we share, this just like got infected with the thrill of technology and really the magic behind it. Also, he was an entrepreneur. I remember him telling me he started a business recording, started a business repairing car radios. So even as a, you know, 12, 13-year-old, he was showed entrepreneurial instincts. Also, he was into music, I mean, because that's what it's all about. So, like, we get so wrapped up with equipment, but at the end of the day, it's music. And that's something my dad always would remind me. It's all about music. Musicians were his favorite people. Making music, being a part of it was really what got him going. And that goes back when he was a child and into the teens. He was a boy singer at the local radio station. So, you know, all the things, you know, making music, technology, entrepreneurial. And then I think finally, one of his most important qualities was he never felt that there should be any reason for him not to be able to do something. When it came to making speakers later on in his life, he never made speakers before. He hadn't really studied speakers. He'd done a lot of other things, but it never occurred to him that he shouldn't be able to do a very good job of that. He knew what he wanted it to sound like. His, you know, lack of experience in that area just didn't stop him. So he was, you know, I think all those traits really, when I look back at the history and I read different things about him, I think that those traits really explain a lot of what he ended up doing. You know, we talk about the various technical things he created. And again, this is kind of in contrast to a lot of we get very wrapped up in gears. It was a very practical matter for him. They just had things they had to do. They had to, build a studio. And the current technology out there from broadcast, from telephone, from telecommunication really wasn't doing what needed to be done to make music in a recording studio. So they started to have to make this stuff for themselves. And then that later became an opportunity to create a business. One of the first things he did was the first use of artificial reverb. And the great story behind this was, this is the Harmonic Cats, the Peg of My Heart, that's always, you know, it's been cited by folks like Bruce Swedeen as something that inspired him to want to record music. And so you probably heard that story. The story I haven't heard as much, but this band was looking to get signed. He actually created a label, signed the band, put it out on his own dime, and it was a million seller. And that actually funded a lot of what he then did, the studios and Universal Audio. So it was a great story. And again, this speaks to his entrepreneurial spirit. As stereo was starting to come in, or he saw it on the horizon, he started recording stuff and mixing it down to mono. And on the side, stereo. He couldn't get the studios at the time to pay for the stereo recording, but he knew that they'd be coming back in the next year or two or three wanting the stereo recording. So he just put it aside, put it in the vault, had a separate room where he dubbed down to stereo. And then when everything went to stereo, he resold them all the same stuff. So. And again, we started off talking about the 1176, and I wasn't around when he was designed. Well, I was around, but not aware of what a FET was, or a gain control circuit was, or a limiter. I was about 3 or 4 years old. But later, I did come across a lot of his design notebooks for that period, so I got an insight into how he was approaching this. And it started off as a project to actually remote control some preamps. He wanted to have a a console that just remote controlled some preamps that could be closer to the studio, and then started to say, oh, if I can remote control this and it can, I can change the gain very rapidly, what if I, you know, have a gain detection circuit and put some feedback around it and it becomes a limiter? And it became a very fast attack limiter.